do something. Hello, good evening everybody, and welcome to the Haze Hour. A little bit later than planned, but nonetheless, here we are. We appear to have a little bit of a delay tonight for some reason. Whatever that reason might be, I have no clue, but we'll try and fix it as we go on. So in the meantime, here are the titles. Hello. We've kind of discovered what's going on, and it turns out that our connectivity here tonight is absolutely shocking. So we've gone to turn all of the other computers in the building off, because that's stopping the show from going out. Wouldn't you just know it? So Keith's disappeared off to get that to happen. This is all to do with, as it turns out, the cloud. Everything's happening in the cloud, and there's all kinds of stuff going on. This is ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. I'm just having a look at the chat to see what's going on. Hopefully it'll not be stuttering. Hopefully it'll not be stuttering. So while that happens, we'll try and get everything sorted out. Certainly what I'm seeing coming back to me on the monitor doesn't look to be too bad, but we're running with about a 30 second delay. Tonight, Keith's just gone to get things sorted out, but tonight we're gonna be doing all kinds of stuff, and I'm under pain of death from the ladies. Gentlemen, I apologise for this, but I'm going to give you some video to watch. This happened during the course of the weekend, and I'm sure you'll understand when I play it in, assuming it plays in from the top. So let's see what happens. You might have known where I was. This might tell you.
Thank you. you look it. You do something to me. Somewhere deep inside. Close to a peace I cannot find. Dancing through the fire, yeah, just to catch a flame, just to get close to, just close enough to tell you that. Something to me, something deep inside. So
that was the wedding that happened on Sunday night. It was canny, wasn't it?
It was. Excellent day.
It was an absolute delight to be there. And I've just been reading some of the comments that are there in the chat. Yes, in an absolute first, I have more hair than the groom. It's because she's got him under the thumb already.
Yeah.
I should also say for the ladies that are watching, that picture that you saw right at the start, at the top of the programme, was Mrs. Studd, if indeed it was there. And the cake, the top tier, was our Y4 flavour, with strawberry underneath, chocolate orange underneath that, and fruit cake underneath that. And funnily enough, when Keith came in, he was just asking us about the e-cigs there.
Yes.
What was it you said?
Right, I was asking if you'd sought permission before the festivities started as to whether you could smoke that or not.
Well, for the first time ever in my life, yes, I did. Because I really didn't want to cause a fuss at my
daughter's wedding.
I definitely not. So on the Saturday when we dropped the cars off, because obviously they were going away for honeymoon.
Yes.
From Lumley Castle.
Yes.
Because she was at a castle, you know, at a castle.
Castle, yeah.
As I would wandered in, and strangely enough, I had that in me hand, just a small one.
Yes,
not a lucky lady, very discreet. And asked the lady on reception. I said, "Are you aware of these?" She says, "Oh, e-cigs, yeah, no bother, son."
Really,
son?
Son, that was a compliment.
She was actually older than me. Still there from the 1600s, I think. Might have been a ghost. So, yeah, we know all about them. You'll be fine. I'll let your wedding coordinator know. That sounded weird as well.
Right.
So that was fine. And as you know, just before we did the speeches, I had a few good talks and blew myself a little cloud of vapour out there before we got a start. And
so did you get the impression from that they allow e-cigs on a routine basis for all their clients?
I think they're aware. I think most places are aware now.
Yes.
They might pretend they're not,
suppose,
but I think they are.
With it not being a sort of conventional licensed premise, that might be a reason. I suppose you could hide anywhere in a castle and have a smoke, couldn't you, really?
Wasn't exactly hiding, were we?
Well, no. When I saw you smoking, well, I did the same.
I think we'll call it vaping.
Sorry, vaping, yes.
Just to be...
Sorry, yes.
We'll call it vaping for tonight. Yes. There was you, there was me, there was Mrs. Studd, who was gorgeous.
Yes.
I mean, Susie, my daughter, somebody in chat room said she is stunning, and she is. But she's got to take after her mum, because she's got to take after me. So there was you, there was me, there was Jill, Mrs. Studd, there was the usher. He was flying.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he nicked one of the Darwins off me for about an hour, and then I chased him down and swapped him across for a tornado tank.
All right.
So he was running around with it, and the next thing I knew, he had a little gaggle of girls and boys around him, all in their early 30s, and they're all stood playing Passy the Parcel with this Tony in a tank. And vaping it up a storm. And more to the point, the band asked them, would they stand in front of the laser lights so they could see the beams? Because you cannot use Haze machines there.
God, all right, Dan. I thought there was just the three of us.
Well, you know, we even had people that don't smoke trying them.
Well, that's a plus, isn't it?
Just a bit. Just a bit. So, aye, a canny night was had by all. However,
canny day. Yeah.
Canny day and a canny night. I will say, however, that judging by the stories I've heard from Vapefest, by the Monday morning I was in no better a state than the folks that had been down there. Oh, dearie me. You know, I've said before, RY4 is the elixir of the gods.
Yes.
It transport you into Elysian fields.
Yes.
Where all sorts of wonderful things. RY High Five takes you a stage further than that, but menthol makes me fart.
Yes.
Well, I don't know what it was. I'd been vaping and drinking on the night, but my God, I was still burping Sam Booker on Tuesday.
Well, given what you told me about the amount of drink you'd had, my guess is it was the drink.
Do you think so?
I think so.
Yes. It couldn't have been these.
No.
No, no, not at all. Anyway, that's although it's very, very vaping related.
You can't have pear cider,
Zambuca,
Jack Daniels, whatever it was.
Jack Daniels and Coke as a stiffener.
Pims.
Two Pims. Yes.
And two bottles of red wine.
Two and a half bottles of red wine when I think about it.
Well, there's your answer.
That was before the speech.
I don't think so.
No, neither do I. Was the world's shortest father-in-law speech?
Speech was very good, I thought.
Did you think so?
Yes.
I'm not used to it, you know.
Very well balanced.
Uh-huh. Was more than can be said for me. Yeah, well, never mind. Enough of this. Shall we do an e-cig programme?
Yes.
Shall we do?
I think that's what we're here for.
Yes.
Yes.
I should point out, ladies and gentlemen, for those of you who, in the chat before the programme started, were wondering what Keith would be pocketing to go away with tonight, he's actually brought something back.
Yes.
And he's brought back this. This is a Fog King tank. And I couldn't have said that on Sunday night at 9 o'clock. This is a Fog King tank. And you haven't had a lot of use out of it, have you?
No.
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 Why would that be? What have you been using in preference to the Fog King tank in the house? And what's it called?
I keep forgetting the name.
It's called a Buzz Pro.
A Buzz Pro.
And
yes.
Where did you get the Buzz Pro?
I borrowed it off you.
Yes. So he's brought me the Fog King tank bank, kept the Fog King Buzz Pro.
Yes.
And I'm gonna say, I mean, how long ago is it since you charged the battery up in this?
Oh, ages. Weeks.
Still working.
That's incredible.
It's lovely.
Because I sort of picked it up and I thought, well, I may as well bring that back.
RY4?
Well, I haven't used that for a long, long time.
So I've got my Fog King tank back. So I'm gonna give it a good Fog King trial. And I might have something to Fog King say about it next Thursday night. You never know your luck.
Hell.
What?
Yes.
You can say it good. Fine. I've just said Fog King. I didn't say anything else.
Fog King tank.
However, while we're talking about tanks.
Yes.
You may well remember, if you were watching the show last Thursday night, that esigs.co.uk put the UFS version 2 on sale last Thursday night. And today, finally, because Vapefest got in the way, mine arrived. And being the dutiful presenter that I am,
yes,
I did a little bit of video on it so that people can see how it goes together and what you get with it. And it's what I've been talking on. This evening. So have a look at this and see how it goes together, and we'll talk a little bit about it, and I might even let you have a go, but no.
Thanks very much.
You're welcome.
So here are the parts of the UFS V2. First, the atomizer connector, which sits inside the collector tank. And this is the collector tank, already ribbed up with the air flow adjuster ring. Next is the bottom section of the tank itself. This is going to hold the atomizer and the juice. And here is the clear window. You also get a solid steel window, for want of a better terms, in case you don't want people to see what juice you're using. And then the top of the tank itself, onto which screws the top cap, which also has this new addition, which allows you to use any mouthpiece or drip tip that you care to mention. So let's put it together. The atomizer connector. And first, we need to put a little bit of grease on it. I'm using a silicone grease here, which is cleared for food use and would be used on the likes of beer pumps and that kind of thing. So just a small amount smeared round the O-ring. And I think I'm probably going to have to use my finger. I've run out of baby buds. So just a small amount of grease on there to lubricate the O-ring and make sure that there are no leaks from any juice that might fall down the atomizer connector and into the collector tank. So let's screw it together. Now the new atomizer connector is all steel, and you will see that there is a little hole because it's not knurled, and that's there to allow you to screw it up good and tight. This wants to be a tight fit. Tight as in, I'm not going to say as tight as you can get it, but it wants to be good and tight. The next job is to lube up and connect the bottom part of the tank assembly. And it wants lubed both on the threads and around the O-ring, which you can see there. And also just a little bit on the inside to lubricate the O-rings that are on the atomizer connector. Now that pushes in until you feel it click, and then you screw. And you might as well screw it all the way down. That way you know that your O-rings are lubed, if this is your first. And now you're going to be ready to put in your atomizer. Now in this case, it's an HH357 long. And what you really do need to do is to pull the pin out. You want to get this atomizer in as far as it will go. All right. So, see if we can find the thread. I'm doing this at arm's length, watching what I'm doing on the camera. And it's very, very difficult to get this threaded. Try again, David. Gently does it. That's it. Now again, this wants to be tight. Don't be wimpy about it. Get it good and tight. And now, on with the window. I like to be able to see the juice. You might not. You can choose which one you want to go with. And again, screw it down good and tight. Right, so it's not just caught, it's as tight as you can get it. We'll leave the steel one for another time. And then on with the top section of the tank. Now you don't actually need to use any lubrication on these two parts. Get them screwed good and tight. You don't want any leaks at all. Okay, now as you can see, that atomizer is sticking quite a way up. So now we've got to look at putting on the top part of the cap, and you'll see how far through the atomizer sticks. You'll also see that it's pushing out the O-ring, which is just as well because I need to get some lube on there. Okay, so luckily I've got some grease on my fingers still. So that's it, silicone lube, not a lot, just enough. And we need to push that down. And then the new shorter top piece goes in. It's got two little indentations, which you can just see. I'll just push that in a little further. Where are your fingernails when you need them? Okay, so now find the threading and screw that down. And the thing is to screw it down and then back it off a little bit, or it'll all go horribly wrong, as you will see in a few minutes when I demonstrate. Now I've taken that quite tight, but that's basically the assembly. And then the last thing, stick your drip tip on and you're pretty much ready to go. It is slightly different from the original UFS, as I'll show you live in the studio, but now let's unscrew that top cap as though we're going to put some juice in without slackening that short nut off, and you'll see what happens. Here we go. and it unscrews the atomizer with it. You have to unscrew that top cap before you unscrew your atomizer. Okay, let's just check that that's tight. Take the pin out, tighten it down, and I'm going to just pull the tank right up to the absolute top, ready to go. And the next job will be to put some juice into the system. So here we are. And because my original UFS is full of RY High 5, we're putting some RY6 into this. I'm not going to measure it, because I can tell you now, you will get 5 mils if you take it right up to the brim, which is exactly what I'm doing. You'll have noticed that before we started this fill, I screwed the tank up to the top so that it met the atomizer, which is what you need to do to stop any juice from falling through into the collector tank. So there we go, almost full to the brim, and now it is. And then we screw, having slackened off that top nut, the top of the tank on. Excuse my hairy hands. That's better. Now you can see. And as you see, if it's gripping at all, it'll be tightening the atomizer in. There's a lot of threads here. Now that's down and just say tightened. And then the gold drip tip goes in. And that's it. Now all we need to do is connect it onto a GGTS. So let's do that. And here we have GGTS serial number 666. It's the beast. In goes the IMR battery, and you'll see I've left quite a gap. Screw it down, and it fits beautifully. Look at that, not a gap to be seen. Tighten the battery up so that it makes a connection. Just making sure that that top nut is snug, but not over tight. It just wants to be snug. Battery up, make sure that the switch is in unlocked position, and we're ready to go. And just opening that juice control a teeny tiny amount. Let's give it a vape. And I'm going to voice over this one purely because I can. First drag off the new UFS V2 with the HH357 in, and that is delightful. So while I take another drag, it's back to me and Keith in the studio. Let's see what Keith thinks of it.
I'm sorry. We've just been reading the chat because the lag is such that we can actually see what's going out and what people are saying. And yes, I suppose we really ought to whisper sweet nothings to various different parts of this before you screw them tight. But go on, what did you say, Keith? Never mind reading what they say.
Would you give me one of those? I just haven't an ear level in engineering. You know,
honestly, seriously and honestly, it's not that hard to do.
No.
It's not. There's an order to it.
Oh, I could see that, yes.
And once you realise how it works, the way the juice flow control works, the way the airflow control works, okay, all right, there is a learning curve.
Yes.
But it's too heavy for you anyway.
Yes.
And I know the chat room's only going to come back and say, give him one to play with.
I don't want... No, well, that would be very nice of them, but I would probably decline.
You would you?
Yes. Happy with what I've got.
So, what is it about this UFS2 that you find difficult? Based on what you've seen.
Right. So you've got it all set up.
Yes.
How often would I have to take it to bits again to do what needs to be done?
Okay.
In other words, get the juice into it, change the batteries, you know, all there must have been, what, about 8 parts there that you assembled? I should have counted them.
Not counting the O-rings.
Yes.
Not counting the... With your rings, it's about 32. no, there's... Right, you've got the bottom section of the JJTS, the telescope section, and the top section. So there's three sections there.
Yes.
And that just unscrews from the bottom like that.
Right.
So that's no different to any other battery holder. That's where, if you like, the faff occurs.
Yes.
But once you've put it together, my experience with the UFS is that atomizers just keep on keeping on. And I'm getting a fortnight out of atomizers. Now, everybody knows when I put the HH357 in that one.
Yes.
And that's been in there now 10 days.
Right.
And it hasn't flackered. The juice has been refilled twice a day. So there's 100 mils of juice has gone through that HH357. Yeah. And putting the juice in is a very, very simple matter of just slackening the bolt off.
Yes.
In fact, I'll show you. That's the easiest way. So you just take your juice control right to the top so no juice can get through.
Yes.
You slacken off this top bolt so that you're not gripping onto the atomizer. And then you unscrew. And I am gripping on, not, am I? No, it seems to be solid. You then unscrew your top part, fill it up with juice, screw your top part back on, and then tighten that top nut up so that it stops too much air from getting in, because you don't want too much air getting in.
Right.
And it's as easy as that. Now, how much juice do you get through a day?
Well, let's look at this one. I probably fill that once a day.
That's the Mega DCC?
Yes.
And how much do you put in?
Half a dozen drops.
Six drops?
Yes.
Right, so you're not using a lot there. How much do you use the Buzz Pro with the bud on it?
Right, probably twice a day. Sorry, not twice a day. Every other day I would be
You'll
filling
fill that up?
Yes.
Right. That tank, that UFS, is going to last you close on a week.
Right.
So once a week you need to fill it up. And if I'm getting through 100 mils,
yes,
that's 20 tanks.
Yes.
So if you're filling it up once a week, it's going to last you 20 weeks. For my 10 fills, you're only going to fill it up once a week. And you're only going to need to change the atomizer very rarely.
Right, so how often would you be charging the battery? Would you be sort of changing batteries every day? Or
I go through two batteries a day.
Right, right.
That's me. A battery would probably last you a week.
Yeah.
See, this is one of the things
that's clearly an advantage.
Well, it's one of the things that confuses me enormously about how people view the longevity of an atomizer or a battery or anything like that. For me, I'm two batteries a day. For you, you're a battery a week at an 18650.
Yeah. I suppose with me, you see, it's all about familiarity.
Mm.
I know what to do with that.
Yes.
And I know what to do with that.
Mm-hmm.
Both of which are very simple and no hassle. And I suppose once you get used to something that's simple,
yes,
you're quite happy to continue with it because it's delivering what you wanted to deliver.
That's why Susie's married Peter.
Well, yes.
I'm the father-in-law.
Good job they're not listening.
It's just as well it might be because you can get it on iPhone.
All right.
I mean, like I've said before to many people, I've come across a lot of brand new users that have said, should I get a GGTS with a UFS? And my advice has been no. You need to have a little bit of confidence in what you're doing because this thing is not the easiest to use. You do have to know how to get the juice control set correctly.
Yes.
You do have to know how to set the air control correctly for you, and it varies for different people.
Yes.
So for Kat, for instance, we've discovered because of the way she is with the Mark T bud, she likes a tight draw, or what I would call a tight draw. I like an airy draw. But there's it's a very, very fine control is the air control on the UFS version 2.
I think if you're talking about a sophisticated, experienced e-cigarette user, that's the kind of thing that you might then go into.
Are you saying I'm sophisticated?
Well, you know, because of what you do, you're interested in all the technicality surrounding it, the science behind it, and all the rest of it.
Mm. It's not a beginner's e-cig.
No, exactly.
It is not a beginner's e-cig. There's no two ways about it. But that said, once you've got the way of how the UFS works,
yes,
you're away and flying. I will say that it will accept a standard UFS tip mouthpiece, that is. It's just a matter of taking that nut out and putting the tip on.
Right.
You will, if you're going to want to use the ordinary mouthpiece, you'll need to get the atomizer extender.
Right.
For the majority of atomizers. But if you're using an XL or an XXL atomizer, like the 357, the HH357 long, just fits in, takes the drip tip absolutely perfectly. I may need to go to a close-up here, so I shall do that, and put the two together in close-up and try and match them up size for size, so that you can see there is a slight difference in size between the new one and the old one. You can tell the difference because the old one's got my stainless steel tip on. So there is a difference between the two, and it's worthwhile realising that, I think. But yeah, I mean, it is slightly longer. I know I need to fill that twice a day, and I'm happy as Larry with that. But the good news is that there's something coming along that's going to make the GGTS with a UFS2 on it, or a UFS on it, even better.
In what way?
Well, you know I'm a big fan. Oh, sorry, before I go there, I should also mention that when you buy the new UFS, as you'll have seen in the video, you also get that, which is the stainless steel window. Only it isn't a window, for if you want a whole stainless steel look. That's the little beastie that fits in instead of the see-through window, if you like, the Lexan window.
Right.
So that just takes it from being completely see-through into not see-through at all. But yes, there's something coming along which is going to drop straight into a GGTS and give it all of the functionality of one of my favourite pieces of kit, which is this, which is the Provari, which...
All right.
I know you weren't massively keen on.
No.
But yes, it will. Mm.
So you're saying you get all of the readings?
No, not the readings at all. Not the display, because with a UFS, you don't need to know.
Right.
Right? You're using all 510 type atomizers, or 306s, or whatever it is you want to put into it. But you want to get the same experience out of that atomizer every time you use it.
Yes.
Right? How would you think if, you know, if Vicky sends you to the shop for a light bulb?
Yes.
And she'll say, mind, Keith, get us a 30 watt one. Yes. I don't want it too bright.
Yes.
How would it be if you could just go and buy any one, any light bulb you like, and stick it into the socket, and without worrying about it, it would just give you that right amount of light?
Right, well, she would probably trust me then to go and buy her light bulbs, if that was the case.
But at the moment, she doesn't.
That's right.
Yes. Well, with what I'm about to talk about and show a little bit of video about, that's exactly what would happen with one of these. And it's called the Evolve Kick.
Right.
And I've got some news coming through for everybody watching this, and I'm pleased to see there's so many people here, because I'm going to need 10 or 15 people.
Right.
And I'll tell you why in a minute when you've seen the video I'm going to show you. Because earlier on today, I was talking with Brandon Ward from Evolve Vapor, the people that make the kick. And the kick is basically a Darwin on a disc. It gives you the functionality of a Darwin, in your GGTS, or in your Silver Bullet, or in your Megalodon, or in any 18650 mod. That's a bit special. And there were a couple of bits of information I wanted to get out of him. And the first one was what the maximum wattage would be.
Right.
Now, this is where we'll come back to light bulbs and stuff like that. I like around about 9 watts. So I would want a maximum wattage of about 10. Just for those moments where you want a big hit. Other people might want a higher wattage. So I asked him, first of all, what the maximum wattage on the production versions was going to be. And this was what he said.
Well, right now, as it stands, the kick only goes to 10 watts. That's the one that you're receiving. It maxes out at 10 watts.
Yeah.
And that's a function of, well, a few different things. Probably the most important one is the batteries. Even with the IMR batteries, we didn't want to overtax them. I mean, you know, we're playing around with where it's going to end up, but at present, it's only it's probably going to top out right around 10 watts. So that's going to be the top. So if you want to go to 12.7 or 12, you're going to need to buy a Darwin. That's what it looks like. And on the top, you can see. Well, I don't know if you can see it or not, but let's see if we can get it in focus here. You can see where it says kicked by a ball. But when you get this, you're going to notice there's a brass piece on the bottom. I don't know if you can see that brass. That's actually works as the battery contact and also the heat sink on the bottom, because the kick does heat up quite a bit. I mean, it gets very hot. The top part, which is the part with the piece coming out here and the potentiometer, that goes toward the bottom part here. The brass part goes toward your battery. This goes up to the top. Now, the production version will have, if somebody puts it in upside down, it won't kill it. Now, this will be spring steel on the side. It'll be a small three-dimensional spring that will come out and bend around to go under the mod. I can barely see my camera, so I can't see if this thing's in focus or not.
It's just about in focus, yes.
Okay, so, but that's it. It's about the size of a U.S. dime. The only thing that's sticking out is the inductor there. That's the only part of it that's raised at all. It's very easy to satellite into various places in mods. I'm trying to get it in focus here. There's your processor and all the good stuff. And there's your through holes to solder your potentiometer, your battery leads and your button right there. If you can see them, they're in three different spots on the board. Yes. And this is more or less the base of the kick. And then, this is also something that you can see. This is the one with the pins, like what you had in your picture, which is the same board, just with pins. And then you have tops that will slide down over top of it. Like if you wanted a potentiometer top, you would just take this, and it slides down over top of those pins. So you can see I've described it as a rector set for modding. But there's all kinds of different things like onboard charging. You can have a top for onboard charging. You can actually layer these up so they can stack right onto those pins. You cut the pins. Once you've stacked your stuff on, you solder the top on, put your next top on, solder it on, and then you can satellite it into your mod or into your tube.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yes. So that was Brandon Ward earlier on today via Skype. Now, I know most of that will have gone straight over the top of your head.
It did, yes.
But basically, what they're coming up with is the ability to put the functionality of a Darwin into any 18650 device.
Right.
Now, what that means in real terms is that you can order, if you like a 510, or if you like one of those Mega DCC cartomizers.
Yes.
Now, at the moment, they're all 1.5 ohms. Okay?
Yes.
But supposing there were only three ohm versions, it wouldn't work quite as nicely.
With you, yes.
It wouldn't be as hot.
Yes.
With the kick in your 18650 mod, let's for argument's sake say in the cube,
yes,
then you could put your Mega DCC on and you don't care what resistance it is. You don't care what its ohmage is. Because the kick board just goes, oh, all right, fine, fair enough. It's 3 ohms. I'll up the voltage and it'll give you whatever wattage it is you've set. So if you want it at 9 watts, it ups the voltage and it reads the resistance of what you've put on.
That is clever.
It's very clever. And the way it works, effectively, it's like an automatic box versus a manual gearbox.
Yes.
So if you want to go at 70 miles an hour, well, actually, it's like setting your cruise control. You set your cruise control for 70 miles an hour in an automatic and you don't have to worry about anything. There's no pedal to press.
So that was like some sort of tiny little circuit board.
Exactly right. Ooh. Tiny little circuit board. No bigger than a pile of pennies, I suppose.
Very clever, that.
It is. The good news is that I will have one by Monday.
Really? And
yes, I will. It's a pre-production beta sample. I will have that by Monday. But here's the better news for everybody that's watching out there. I'm going to need 10 or 15 people. Because we in the UK and Europe are different from our friends in America. We know. We spell properly. They spell quickly.
Yes.
And phrases like that. They produce juices with barrel loads of flavour and different flavours. And we're different. We're two nations divided by a common language. I've also noticed that our American cousins really do like hotter vapour than we do.
Oh, right.
Right? Now, I don't know why that is, but they like spicier food than we do. A
cultural thing.
It's a cultural thing. So, Brandon at Evolve has asked me if I would hand out some kicks
right
to some people over here for them to beat a test. 10 or 15, don't know how many, but there'll be a few, and I will have them by November the 12th. And on November the 12th, that's when the knees up is happening at the OK Diner on the A19 just north of Billingham. I've posted about this in the All About Forum and UKV and various other places. So if you're on there, you need to be coming. And if you're interested in getting involved with this, there are some people that I know I want to have, and I want inexperienced 18650 users as well as experienced. So I'm going to give you one to play with.
That's very kind of you, David.
I thought you might like that.
Yes.
Because I reckon if you can get away with it,
anybody can.
Exactly right. And what Brandon wants us to do is basically pick the snots out of it.
Right.
He wants to know the bad as well as the good. The idea behind this is to get it right and make it as easy as possible for as many people as possible. Now, I'm over the moon about this.
That's quite groundbreaking, isn't it? I mean, really what he's saying is, look, this is something that's in the experimental, developmental stage.
Yes.
Let's try it out on our English cousins. Really.
Well, it's not just the English
cousins.
Well,
I realise that, but I mean,
but what has happened is that Evolve has recognised that there are differences in the way we use e-cigs over here from the way they use them over there.
Yes.
And in order to be able to work for everybody, it's going to make it available for everybody.
Yes.
So yes, we'll have a big chunk of UK-based beta testers. And we need beginning users, if you like, naive users,
yes,
as well as experienced users. So I'm going to be looking for these people. I don't know how many are coming over. As soon as I know how many are coming over, obviously I'll let you know. And we're gonna do this for them. We're gonna beta test these kick units, the Evolve kick. Now, there's all kinds of other information about these that's going to be coming through, but I can't share that with you just yet because I'm under a non-disclosure agreement. But let me tell you now, it's exciting. It is really, really exciting. I think this is going to be groundbreaking.
It certainly sounds that way, doesn't it?
It's the ability to plug any light bulb into the socket and get exactly the amount of light you want.
And I mean, the fact that, you know, he as an American innovator is wanting to test the market in this country through us. That's what it amounts to.
Through Vapor Trails TV. Yeah. Yes. Yes. And I really, really do want us to get involved, because this gives us as UK e-cig users the chance to shape the future of vaping, not just in the UK, but worldwide.
Yes.
Shall we drink to that?
We shall.
We'll drink to that. Cheers. That gives us the excuse to fill the glasses when we're there. Yes. Would you care for a little more, sir?
If you were having some, yes, sir.
I think I could be tempted. It's a cheeky little wine. Le Passion.
Very nice.
Le Passion. It's pink. Matches my shirt.
Appropriate, yes. Le Passion.
Le Passion. I like Le Passion.
The passion.
The passion, yes. Oh, I'm a big follower of passion, I am.
Well, we won't go into that.
No, probably best not. So I'm going to plug that meetup again. I mean, and it, you know, kick aside, evolve kick aside, the knees up, the North East E-Smokers, on the 12th of November, that's a week after Bonfire Night, at the OK Diner, just north of Billingham on the A19, from 6 o'clock onwards. I'll be there, Kat will be there, Sav will be there. There may be a Paula there, although I'm not saying which one. And here's the good bit. If you missed it at Vapefest or you didn't make Vapefest, the E-Hooker will be there.
Right.
Yes, the Hubble Bubble. The E-Hooker. We'll have the E-Hooker there. Ben's agreed to lend us that for that. That's come from ECWKELiquids.co.uk. UKWKELiquid. That's ECWK E-Liquid. I can't. It's ECW and UK E-Liquid put together. It's Ben.
Right.
Basically, he's lending us the E-Hooker.
Right.
For the 12th. So are you going to make that one? Did you check your diary?
I didn't, as a matter of fact. Well, I must do that.
You Tinkerbell.
That's not this weekend, not the next, but the one after that.
The week after Bonfire Night.
That's a Saturday.
That's a Saturday night. 6 o'clock, OK Diner. It's on the forums. It's on all of the UK forums. All About and UKV. I've got a couple of threads on there.
Right.
So get yourselves along, because I'll have the kicks by then. That was what Brandon said today. The kicks will be there by then, and I'll need to be giving some out, because obviously we need to get feedback as quickly as possible. It's a unique opportunity. These opportunities don't come along every day. It normally happens on forums. It's happening on Vapor Trails TV.
It's exciting, though.
It's thrilling me. Yeah, absolutely thrilling. I see the kit as being a game changer. It thrills me. I think the Provari is a wonderful piece of kit, and the idea of being able to get all of the functionality of a Provari in terms of how it allows you to use it into a tube mod, that's just thrilling. Absolutely thrilling. Yes, that's brilliant. Now, we've got around about 8 minutes left, so there's one piece of kit I want to have a look at, and I don't know how this is. Well, it will interest you, because your device of choice that's device never out of your hand, your Buzz Pro.
Oh, yes.
I said you're there, didn't I?
You did. Yes, you are. Yes.
Well, it takes two batteries, doesn't
it? I might even be able to establish ownership, you know, the length of time. No, I won't go that far. It does take two batteries.
You're not seeking to appoint a solicitor, are you?
No, I wouldn't dream of it.
Out of it, how many batteries are you going through a day? How many times do you need to recharge?
Every 2 or 3 days.
Okay, so you wouldn't... A two-channel charger is more than enough for you, then?
Yes.
There are plenty of people for whom a two-channel charger is not enough, and they need four channels.
Right.
Yes, and I'm one of them. And there it is. This is, as you can see, a Trustfire TR003P4. And inside it, at the moment, is sitting a pair of 18650 IMRs. Now, This came through to me earlier on this week, ordered from those awfully nice people at Mojo Republic. And it's really rather nice. I'll do that one. No, not that one. That one. That's the one I'll do. There you go. So people can see it in the screen behind us up there. Four-channel charger. And I have to say, thus far, I'm quite chuffed with it because there doesn't appear to be a problem. Oh no, of course, I've already fully charged that battery, haven't I? That's always a good idea. It won't show that it needs a charge. But it'll take just about any size battery you care to put in it. And that one obviously does need to take a charge. Yeah. What else have I got that's not charged? That might not be charged, so we'll clag that in. And there you go. We've got four batteries on charge, four red lights. The one thing I've noticed, and as you can see how easy it is, that's all at fingertips. The one thing I have noticed, though, it doesn't like a battery going under 2.5 volts.
All right.
It's not that
very
keen.
Handy if you have two people who are e-smokers in the one house.
Oh, without a doubt. Without a doubt. I mean, there's just Jill and myself.
I was thinking of that.
So yeah. it's great. And for me, it means I can keep two GGs on the go or whatever and have the batteries in there recharging in any mix that I care to mention. And I think for 14.5 quid, it's not bad value at all.
It isn't.
In fact, I think it's very good value. That's from Mojo Republic, 14.5 quid. Comes with a proper UK plug and everything. And the nice part about it is, I'll go back to that other shot. It's got a lid on, which is nice. Now, thus far, I think I've now charged about 12 batteries on it.
Right.
In the week that it arrived on Monday. So, and I'll be honest, I didn't do a thing with it on Monday.
No. No. Well, you wouldn't be able to.
No, I could barely see to drive home.
Yes.
No, I wasn't drunk.
Drive home.
No, I wasn't drunk. Oh, no, we left.
Of course, yes.
It's about 2 o'clock in the afternoon when we got back, if you recall.
It was, yes.
Because no, I didn't dare.
I wondered where you were.
No. But yeah, I didn't do anything with it Monday, and I've put about 12 batteries through it since it came on Monday, and it just works.
Yeah, it's a very neat sort.
It is neat.
Yes.
It's not going to attract any attention. Very nice. It will also take 12 volt in if you want to charge on the move.
All right.
And the cords for that are fairly easily available too. So yes, I just thought people might like to see that existed. And now that those batteries are charging, I shall leave them charging, I think.
Yes.
It's probably not a bad idea.
Yes.
Because they obviously need a charge. And we'll go back to the close-up of the two old blokes.
Two old blokes.
Safer Sigs has said 18650. What's that then? That'll tell you how long ago it is. We're running with a 5 or 6 minute delay here, but we're very, very close to the end of our allotted time. And I don't think there's anything else I need to mention, but I will need people. Just get in touch with me if you're interested in this beta program with the kick. Make it up on the 12th if you can. It'll be worthwhile. Be well worth your while. I'm really looking forward to seeing these coming through.
Yes.
And obviously next week I will be reporting back on the pre-production kick in as many different devices as I can try it. And I'll keep people up to date on the UFSV
too. Remind me, when are we doing the beginners programme?
We were looking at week beginning 7th of November, but we need to put that back a little bit.
Right.
Because we want to get this right, so we need everybody to know exactly what they're doing. And to be honest, it takes an awful lot of planning. So we've dropped that back a little bit because next week, let me remind you, on Wednesday, and this is without not ignoring everybody else's show, but on Wednesday of next week, we're doing another live outside broadcast. It's VT Talk from the TW shop, the Totally Wicked shop in Wigan, with Mr. Jason Cropper himself. Mr. Wicked may be there or may not, we don't know, and we don't know who else of the team is going to be there, but Jason Cropper will certainly be there. So next Wednesday night, please get tuned in, get your questions lined up early. It's going to be a mega show from the Totally Wicked e-cig vaping shop in Wigan live next Wednesday night at the earlier time of 8 o'clock. We're going to go out at 8 o'clock because it's a long drive home, and there's an awful lot of stuff to be done. So we're rapidly approaching our time. I'm going to keep it basically to what we've covered, and ask you all please to tune in tomorrow night at 8 o'clock for In the Corner with Mighty Mouse, when you'll see his report from VaporCon, which happened last weekend.
All right.
That's the big American show equivalent to our Vape Fest. And there was all kinds of good stuff happening there. And Mike has got footage and all kinds of stuff, all sorts of news stories and what have you from VaporCon. I'm going to be tuning in for absolutely certain. Saturday night is Halloween.
Yes.
So if all the good ladies, all the good looking ladies can bare their necks, Keith and I are going to come round and bite you on the neck.
Right.
Either that, or if you're anything like me, I'm going to be poisoning kids.
Yes.
I've got blue pea sweets. I've got ghost pepper sweets. I've got all kinds of stuff.
I'm at a Halloween party.
Are you? Well, you know it's trick or treat?
Yes.
Not here.
All right.
Only trick.
Only trick.
Only right. trick. We don't do sweets.
Right.
No. They look like sweets. But they're not.
They're not.
2 years ago, I gave them all chocolate laxatives, you know.
Oh, God.
Absolutely. Well, they're in training for the Great North Run. I just didn't understand what the Great North Run was.
Yes.
Then Sunday, we may have, at 8 o'clock, an Andy Sutton. We may have the Smoke the Vape show. We don't know yet because we're not sure what he's working. That'll be followed by Dave Kitson. Then on Monday, the Vapormists. You can't miss the Vapormists. Brilliant lads, brilliant show last week, and it'll be a brilliant show this week as well. Followed by The Witching Hour with Cat and Sav, that'll be cool.
What a packed, exciting week.
It never stops here on Vapor Trails TV. And can I also give a great big welcome to all the new folks that are here tonight, because I see we've had 130 odd people.
Really?
And it's all gone black, for whatever reason. That's it, my connection's gone down. Damn. Is it back? Yes, it's back. Okay. Connection's really bad tonight. So I'm going to cut it there before it disappears altogether and say thank you very, very much for tuning in. Until we see you next time. This is Keith and I saying thank you for tuning into the Haze Hour. Welcome to all the newbies. We'll see you all next week, and hopefully we can get these internet gremlins sorted out. Until then, have a great week, and tune in tomorrow night for In the Corner with Mighty Mouse. Night night.
Thank you. Good night.
Bye bye.